This is a rare treat to have James Kuffner of the Toyota Research Institute Advanced Development with us. He is the Chief Executive Officer. I think, is it fair, James, to think of you as Toyota's Chief Scientist?
Well, I was just recently named as a Senior Fellow, but I'm really looking at trying to build software technology, and we can talk more about that. But Toyota's been building technology for transportation, but now we have new technology, artificial intelligence, and that's really the interesting part, I think.
We're going to see some of that right now. James has brought a short video for you to watch. We were looking at some self-driving car technology there, were we not?
So those are just some of the features that we're going to be shipping to customers next year. And of course, there's been a lot of excitement about automated driving technology and how it's going to train transportation. And Toyota has an approach that really is trying to build what we call teammate. So instead of completely replacing the human driving skill, that works in partnership with an AI system, and we think that together that can be a safe, convenient form of mobility.
That looks an awful lot like Tesla's autopilot. So why is that still, if you will, in the lab? And autopilot is in hundreds of thousands of cars that are already on the road.
I won't comment on our competitors' approaches to things, but of course, you know, one of the most valuable assets that Toyota has is its brand value. And the quality and reliability is something that our customers expect. And so we make sure that we build new technologies that we feel confident. And I think, you know, some of the features you that we show there are not yet out by anyone. And so, you know, whether it's overtaking and passing and some of those other things that we are doing automatically in a hands-off way. Autopilot, as you know, is hands-on. So there's lots of different, I think, competitive features that we will be unveiling as we go forward. And one of the nice things about this car, it will be a really powerful supercomputer on wheels, and it will be fully upgradable over the air, the first such car that Toyota and Lexus Group has built.
When you say you're going to be shipping this technology to customers next year, should I assume that those customers are Toyota, or is this going to be licensed to other manufacturers as well?
TRIAD is actually a joint venture mm-hmm. between Toyota, Denso, and Aisin. And so we're actually looking at how we can make some of the software that we're building available to the world. And we've already announced at CES earlier this year, Dr. Gil Pratt, who's the CEO of TRI, has talked about how we're making Guardian, our Guardian safety system, available to everyone. Because in many ways, safety, the environment, those things are really about the future of our planet, and so we should make those technologies available to all. But with the first launch of this next product, it will be, of course, a vehicle within the Toyota Group.
I know you're reluctant to talk about competitors. However, you touched on a very important philosophical difference between the way that Toyota approaches the development of technologies such as TeamMate and what other companies such as Tesla are doing. Explain why you don't want to take the other approach, which is effectively real-world trials with the potential for real-world accidents.
Actually, Toyota has always tested in the real world all of our technologies. Of course, we do closed course, we do public road testing, and we do extensive user testing. And that's a core part of our strength, actually, is the infrastructure and know-how required to bring new technologies to market. We brought the hybrid Synergy Drive, sold over 10 million of those cars, saved countless numbers of rainforests by doing so. The safety technology we brought to market, the first in-lane pedestrian avoidance, so we can swerve now up to 1.4 meters in lane to avoid hitting a person, even if the driver is not paying attention. So I think there's a lot of new technologies that we've always been building, but we tend to be a little bit understated, I would say, and maybe we can improve on that to basically make people aware of all the technologies that we're bringing to market. But we stand by our products and about our processes for testing. And one of the big challenges, actually, is that with the complexity of the software that we're seeing today with automated driving, there is no amount of physical testing that you can do to actually validate and verify the quality. So that's why we have incredible simulation tools. So we're testing billions of miles virtually to find and fix bugs in the software prior to and in parallel to the actual physical world on both closed course and public road testing. And many people are doing that as well.
You're on record as saying that level 5 self-driving, which is total automation, right? No human input whatsoever, is a lot further away than people think.
Yes.
Why?
Part of the reason is that it requires not only getting the technology right and getting it really robust and safe, but also, in many ways, working with society. Society has to decide how quickly and how to embrace this technology. And, you know, level 5 is a system that can drive anywhere a human can drive, under any weather, under any traffic condition, without a map. And right now, the technology doesn't exist for that. Nobody's even close. But if you start to constrain it, level 4, you say good weather, light traffic, maybe even a dedicated lane, lower speed, and you have a very good map, I think you can deploy that technology today. So it depends on how much value you're getting from deploying that and what the cost is. But right now, you know, from a capability point of view, we still have a lot of unsolved technology problems, and also the society has to also embrace it. And every country's different.
So when competitors, again, promise total automation, are they either overpromising what's possible, or are they not being quite honest with us about what that total automation actually is?
Maybe a bit of both. But I would say that there is a bit of confusion in the media right now between two very different
products.
Hang
on a second. The media have never been confused.
There's two different products that were often talked about and often conflated. The first product is the car you buy that will drive for you and take you wherever you want to go, and you can take a nap. Okay, that's one product. Okay, that's far off.
How far?
Again, it depends on how quickly the technology gets solved. But
your best guess at the moment.
It'll happen before I am too old to drive. At least that's my goal. Okay. Is by the time I'm too old to drive, I won't have to. I do think that the other product is the mobility as a service, the driverless taxi. That one is fleet owned, fleet operated, professionally maintained. When the weather's bad, you don't send it out. If the map is an error, you can go fix it. That is actually much nearer to market. You could say I could do a dedicated route at lower speed in a dedicated lane. We can have a driverless car today doing that. But those are two different, very, very different products. And so when people often say, oh, we're going to have that today, we're going to have that next year, some people are imagining that, oh, I'm going to go out and buy one. and then I'm going to be responsible for maintaining it, and it won't cost that much. And that it just isn't true. So we actually have these two very different products. But the technology for them is quite overlapping. But the sensors, the cost and the capability, the hardware and the software and the algorithms, all of those actually need a lot of improvement in order to ultimately achieve the dream, which is a level 5 system that will be a replacement for a human driver, and it can drive you anywhere you want, and you can go take a nap in the backseat.
I've already mentioned one of the other companies in the self-driving car business. Here's an opportunity for you to be complimentary. Who's doing stuff that excites you, that you think is really interesting in the world of self-driving cars, and what is it that they've done caught your attention?
Well, I mean, we've had a lot of new technologies related to sensing. So we have a proof of concept of a 2-camera system with a 30-watt carbon-based supercomputer. That is a human. So the human driver is the proof of concept that we can actually, you know, build something like this. But actually getting a system to be as good as a human may not be enough. And here's the reason why. Most of the accidents and injuries that are happening are due to human error. And there's 1.3 million people all over the world every year dying. So if we build a system that's as good as a human, I'm not sure society will accept that. We actually have to be superhuman. And so that's why investing in superhuman sensing technologies. We have infrared LIDARs that can see great at night. We have radar that can see 200 meters even when it's foggy and heavy rain and dark. So we are building omnidirectional, multimodal, superhuman sensing capabilities, and then using cutting-edge state-of-the-art algorithms to try and actually create a driver that is superhuman in terms of safety and performance. And then I think society will say, oh, that is the trade-off we'll accept. And I think the same thing happened with airplanes. A lot of people in the early days said, I will never fly an airplane that's driven by a computer, when autopilots on airplanes came out. But now people say, if you have zero visibility, high wind, you absolutely want the computer flying the plane. And I think eventually that will happen. We will have superhuman, safe driving capabilities.
What other technologies or technological applications are priorities for you at Triad beyond self-driving cars? Because you describe your mission as developing things for human amplification. Explain.
Yes. So around the time that AI was being thought about in the 1950s, there was another school of academics and thinkers who were thinking about intelligence amplification, or IA. How does technology amplify the human ability to think or to analyze? And I think that's very complementary in the way that we approach a lot of these technologies. When we think about how technology for manufacturing, we now have robots that can build things with precision and scale much better than a human could without it. And now we have AI technology and software that will amplify human ability to analyze data at scale and speed that we could have not done before. And that is actually transforming the industry. So when it applies to Toyota and what we're doing at TRIAD, we are trying to take the hardware strength and the process that Toyota has built for producing electromechanical systems at scale and speed, the famous Toyota Production System, or TPS, and we're trying to make an equivalent process for software. Because the reality is that the vehicles and mobility solutions of tomorrow are going to be a huge amount of software and not just hardware. And if either one of those is weak, you have a weak product. And so we want to build the excellence in Toyota Production System for software so that we can actually have a great product.
Beyond the applications you've already described, where else might we see this in the future?
So it was announced at CES in 2008 when Akio Toyoda, our president, had said that Toyota is going to become a mobility company, not just a car company, and that's very much in vogue now. But it really is true that now there's so many possibilities with robotics and other forms of mobility, higher energy density, power sources, whether it's coming from fuel cells or electrification. All of these things are adding new possibilities, and with the sharing economy and connectivity. So all of these things are making it possible to have artificial intelligence powering mobility devices of the future. And those things, it's really exciting to me when they're interacting with the physical world and not just processing data.
I want to get to another philosophical point, which is this. The objective at TRIAD is to find ways for humans and machines to work synergistically. You are very upfront about the fact that you want to complement human ability and not replace it. Why?
I think any technology should not be made just for technology's sake. It has to be helpful for people. And I think that is a really core value of Toyota. Over 100 years ago, it was an automated loom company and didn't make cars at all. And the reason was is that Sekichi Toyota had saw his mother weaving and said, I would like to help her and make her more productive and more efficient to making clothes. And they built this beautiful automated loom, and Toyota still makes a lot of the world's automated looms. But then they sold that patent to the Platt brothers for the equivalent of 10 million pounds back in the 20s and put everything in building a car business. And so now we would like to take the successful car business and invest in new technologies for the future, but they should be technologies that help people have healthy, happy, more productive lives. And there's a lot of fear right now in the world about AI essentially replacing humans, and you lose what this wonderful concept in Japanese called ikigai, which is a meaningful life. How can all of us have a meaningful life where we're supported by technology?
Are those fears justified?
I think definitely, oftentimes, unfortunately, technological advancement will outpace our thinking about the philosophy and ethics of how the technology can be deployed in our world. And of course, every technology is a double-edged sword. But I think that if we set out from the beginning to say, we want to create something that will help people and have people at the center and amplifying human ability, whether it's communicating. Look at how cell phones have amplified humans' ability to communicate instantly, anywhere, with anyone in the world at any time. This similar revolution is going to happen with AI and software and data processing. Now we should be able to create tremendous new value by having a tool that can assist people. I like the Star Trek computer, the computer that you can ask advice from, but you still make the decision yourself.
James, you're an American who studied and taught at American universities, but who came to Japan. If the ethos of tech in America can be summed up, and I mentioned this earlier, by Facebook's erstwhile motto, move fast and break things, how would you describe the ethos of tech in Japan?
One of the things that I love about being here is there is a tradition of craftsmanship and quality. And many people have said that the search for perfection in something usually has an ulterior motive, but in Japan, achieving perfection is in itself a good enough goal. And I love that spirit. And the hard work, the teamwork, the quest for quality, all those things are complementary with, I believe, being open, not being afraid to fail, and the high-speed innovation of Silicon Valley. So our company is really trying to be a new kind of company that will combine speed and agility and innovation of Silicon Valley, where I lived 20 years of my life, and the quality and craftsmanship of Japan. And I think we have a great chance to do it here. And moving fast and breaking things honestly doesn't work when you're talking about automated driving, where people are at risk. So I'm sorry, but we're going to stick to our quality and craftsmanship instead.
I heard an anecdote about what happened when you tried to change the dress code. No more business suits. Tell us about that.
We had a lot of interesting kind of cultural things that we wanted to explore. And you know, there were many people who actually, so HR, after I said, okay, I want everybody who's not customer facing, just come to work casually, just whatever makes you feel comfortable and productive, just come to work. And HR came to me the next day and said, James, you're causing people stress. And I said, why? He said, they don't know what to wear. Because it was like a uniform. I mean, essentially, you know, if you work for Toyota, you come to work every day, you kind of you have a uniform. You don't have to think about it in the morning. But people are like, I don't know what to wear, and I don't have a good, cool wardrobe or whatever. So we decided that the solution was we're going to give them TRI AD jackets. And they're comfortable and very warm. And so T-shirts and jackets, those kinds of things, it's just a small thing. But it actually does change the mindset. It does make people and the atmosphere very different.
Is it true that some of your people were reluctant to leave home not in a business suit because they were concerned that their neighbors would look at them and think they'd been fired?
Yes. That was also, I was informed that some of the spouses were embarrassed that if their husband left the house wearing casual clothes, all the neighbors would think they were fired and they were homeless or something like that. So these things I would have never, ever imagined. So the solution was actually that we decided to give people lockers. So it's true. Some people actually put on a suit, they get on the train, they commute, they come to work, and then when they get to the office, they put on a T-shirt and sneakers and write code. And then they put the suit back on before they go home.
Phenomenal story. One last question for you. Before I'm afraid we do have to wrap up, the past 20 years or so have ushered in some of the most remarkable technologies the world has ever seen, almost by definition. Maybe we'll ever see, who knows? We've already talked about some of them, sensing, for example, obviously extraordinary advances in computing power, machine learning, more broadly artificial intelligence. Where do you expect to see the next great technological advances?
Well, I'm really excited about robotics, and essentially, if you think about the cloud, what it has done, the most complex machine that humans have ever created is a computer. And I always mention the anecdote that you cannot design today's computer without a computer. And it isn't just a single one, they're all connected now, and they're available instantly with massive power that we couldn't have imagined in just 20 years ago. So to me, when you connect that information processing and data processing power with the physical world, whether it's a connected car that provides mobility or a robot that's connected to the cloud, the problem of programming a robot has always been that the robot breaks down before you have enough data to train your machine learning system to make it really skilled. And so one of the concepts that I've been thinking about for a long time is the concept of cloud robotics. Instead of building one robot and having it run for 10,000 hours, let's build 100 robots and have them all run in parallel for 100 hours and collect the same amount of data, and then every robot learns from the experience of every other robot. And that is how we can actually build better capability on a shorter time frame. And to me, cloud robotics, connecting the computing power of the cloud system with connected robots that can actually change the physical world is really exciting, and there's so many possibilities for human life to be amplified with that.
Do you believe in the singularity, that someday, somewhere distant in the future, man and machine will be one and the same?
I actually am more of, I guess, a fan of the idea of humans being at the center, but surrounded by lots of tools and powerful tools. I mean, already a calculator can do billions of arithmetic operations much better than any human could. The chess playing program on your smartphone can defeat the grandmasters today. But does that dehumanize us? Does that somehow make us not lose our meaning in life? I would like to see a future where we are actually empowered and amplified by this, not replaced by it, and probably a little bit separate. I want to be able to turn my computer off when I want to.
Technology, utility, philosophy. Please join me in thanking James Kuffner of TRI AD.